All right, let's get these sleeves rolled up. You know what today is? Today is story time. I've made a change in my programming. It's a good change. It's a change for the better. I'm actually doubling my programs, twice the amount of programs. What I'm doing is my standard Praxis 55712 program is going to be on Sunday night, like always, or Monday morning, whichever. It doesn't really have a certain day. Generally, it's Sunday night to Monday morning. That's when the regular programs come out. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add Thursday as story time, and that way I can have a reading of stories and interaction with you on a more personal level. That would be an additional thing. That way, for those of you who don't enjoy story time, you could just skip that and enjoy the programming on Sunday night with outdoor gardening, all kinds of fun stuff going on. Those of you who do enjoy story time, you can join me for this. So it's a little bit of something for everybody. I hope you do enjoy that. Now, where we left off, I do enjoy story time. I gotta admit, I really do. And it's for the sole reason of I've never really had this thing where people enjoy me sharing parts of my life. I just never really had that. So this is something that's new to me because I'm not a very public person when it comes to sharing my past. This is an opportunity for me to do that. I've noticed that a lot of people do enjoy that. So thank you, everybody, for the encouragement to continue with this. I really do appreciate it. Where we left off on the book was, and this is a few weeks ago, so I'm going to just recap really quick. I did my bean garden when I was, I think, 9 years old. I told you the story about that. That's one of the big things that got me into gardening, was that little instance. For those of you who want to check up on the previous story times, you can go to my channel and do a search in the search bar on the main page for story time. I have them labeled story time 1, 2, 3, and so on. That way you can watch whichever one you want. If you want to start at the beginning and have a story time marathon, kind of like a Netflix, you can do that. Or you can just jump in at any time, because any time is a good time to get to know me. So my last program was about the bean garden, and I'm going to continue from there. All right. And it starts with the wonder years, and they were really the wonder years. The wonder years of my life were spent in Gardendale. Gardendale were the apartments that we lived in. The older boys who used to tease me eventually lost interest in bullying me as their interests matured into noticing girls. That generally is the way that things happen, you know. They're focused more on young boy things, and then eventually as they get a little bit older, their interests turn to romance and stuff. And so that was actually a good thing for me, because they weren't so focused on chasing me down. Life got a little easier, and I even managed to make a new friend. Yes, I did. My first friend, actually. My first real solid friend. I know Erica was my first friend, but this was like the boy thing. You know, every boy has to have a boy for a friend to do all the things that boys do. Donnie was my first friend. Donnie lived just outside Gardendale in a small stucco white house with hard-packed dirt for a yard and a frantic red-headed mother who never seemed to stop moving. And she was a very busy person, I remembered, and I really did enjoy that. Her hair wasn't red. I don't know why they call redheaded people redheads. Their hair is actually orange. Most people's redheads people are orange. Hers was blaze orange, the color of fire, and it fascinated me. She was the first redheaded person I ever saw. Anyway, back to the story. I'm sorry. Cleaning, cooking, hanging clothes with never a moment to stop moving or talking. Donnie, bring me your dirty clothes. Wanda, pick up the dishes. Demetrius, wipe your nose. Honey, you have a booger. Where's Consuela? Well, who's watching Consuela? And Consuela was one of those things. It's kind of like The Simpsons. Nobody really knows where Maggie is half the time on The Simpsons cartoon. And Consuela was like that. Consuela was a little toddler who was barely crawling. Nobody ever knew where she was. But she was always somewhere in the house, underneath the bed, gathering dust bunnies, behind the couch. She was always somewhere. And that's one of the things I remember, is little Consuela. She always had dust bunnies on her, and she was always going about her business, because their mom, Donnie's mom, had her hands totally full. Donnie's home was always a hub of activity and disarray, with the comfortable feel of life and love underneath the chaos. And it really was that feeling. Donnie and I found each other as many young boys find each other. We rode bikes. One day I saw Donnie popping wheelies on his bike, and this, of course, was a valid reason to become friends. Who wouldn't want to be friends with the only 9-year-old who could ride a wheelie for a full half block? That was quite the thing back in the day. We rode bikes, and wheelies were the epitome of achievement. And Donnie, I don't know how he did it. He tried to teach me. I could never do it as good as him. He could ride a wheelie half a block, and that was just incredible to watch a bike up like that. And he did it with such no effort, and something that was so easy for him was so impossible for me. From our first meeting on those bikes, we were like peas and carrots, beans and rice, roast beef and potatoes, homemade bread, I forget where I was going with this. But every day was a ritual of riding my bike to Donnie's house and asking his mother if he could come out to play. His mother was more than likely a bit irritated by this tiny new boy always coming to remove her son from chores, but that was my job, and I did it well. With a deft toss of the daily trash into the trash can, Donnie was on his bike racing towards the distance with me fast on his trail, as the fading echoes of "Donnie, you be back before lunch" were soon to be a forgotten warning. Oh, I got yelled at so many times by his mom for keeping him out. But that's what I did, because I had nothing else to do, and Donnie was my world. He was my friend, I was his friend, and we would just lose track of the day, lose track of time. We would just go out, and it was adventure time every single day in the summer. First order of the day usually consisted of pop bottle hunting. An allowance was unheard of for most, if not all, Gardendale children. Donnie lived outside Gardendale, but his situation was much the same. Poor but happy was the life we led, and this lack of financial cushioning led to some much needed creativity. And that is true. When you don't have much, you get very creative to get the things that you want. Glass soda pop bottles could be scavenged in trash cans behind the taverns and motels. In rare but wonderful occasions, an entire six-pack of empty bottles would be spotted next to a trash can, ripe for the picking. Apparently, these adults were blissfully unaware that they were throwing out 30 cents of absolutely free money. 30 cents was a veritable gold mine at our age. Those beautiful, unwanted bottles could be returned to any store for actual money. Imagine that. 30 cents equates to 30 pieces of bubblegum, or any number of other delicious sugary penny treats at the local convenience store. And back then, of course, you know, I am old. I remember candy being a penny. Soda pop bottles were made out of glass. Nowadays, they're made mostly out of plastic. But back then, they were all made out of glass. You could return them for a deposit, and the stores would have to give you a deposit. Every store was like that in our town. I don't know about your town, but our town, they would do that. And I don't really think that the cashiers were glad to see us, because we'd bring in these dirty bottles that were in the dirt, filthy dirty, crammed into the little six-pack holders. We'd bring them in, and sometimes they'd say, no, you have to go wash them. So we'd have to run them home, wash them in the hose, put them back in the cartons, and bring them back and return them for money. After a couple hours of bottle collecting, we would pool our haul, and with a little luck, this amounted to $1 of easy money. That's 50 pieces of candy each. Bazooka bubblegum was my candy of choice, but Tootsie Rolls called to me like a siren just two shelves up. So many choices. And there were so many choices there. There was bubblegum, there was Tootsie Rolls, there was Bit of Honeys, you know, all the old candies, Jawbreakers, round candy, and things that we didn't even know what they were. You didn't know if it was Jawbreaker or gum until you actually put it in your mouth. Maybe a Tootsie Pop or three to mix things up. Oh, hey, look, they have those huge Jawbreakers with gum inside. I remember those things too. They were, I think they were a nickel. And they weren't just Jawbreakers or candy that, you know, were this size of this. They were the big ones. Remember, those of you who are older, you remember the big Jawbreakers. They were huge, and you could barely get them in your mouth. If you were a small kid, you were messed up. If you got those in your mouth and you couldn't get them out, you had to literally keep them in your mouth and suck on those things until they were small enough to get out of your mouth. And they were so big that you really couldn't break them. So we'd walk around with these things in our hand, just gnawing on them like chipmunks. What can you say? A nickel went a long way back then, but you know, to this day, I still think of Bazooka as one of my favorites. I don't have as many teeth as I used to have when I was a kid. My teeth aren't as strong. But once in a while, yeah, Bazooka bubblegum. It lasts forever. It lasts forever and you can blow bubbles with it. That's like two candies in one with the jawbreaker because they had the gum on the inside. Oh, the excitement and the smells of the candy store. There on the tile floor, and I mean dirty tile floor, right where everybody walks. There on the tile floor, we would plop down on our butts and select our treats. Finally, after what seems an eternity of hard choices, we piled our selections on the counter for purchase. Sales tax? Huh? What is sales tax and why do we have to pay it? That's 3 cents. That's three pieces of gum. No. No. That can't be right. We didn't pay tax last week, so why now? Oh, because last week I spent only 25 cents and sales tax is charged for anything over 25 cents. Yep, that's how they worked it. Up to 25 cents, no sales tax. 25 cents and above, they started charging sales tax. One penny for 25 cents and all the way up to a dollar, you'd pay 3 cents in sales tax. Yes, the wheels were turning in our little heads and we found the loophole to their sinister plan. We would simply purchase 24 cents worth of candy and then repeat this process three more times. Two financial geniuses we were. The bored teenage cashier did not share our enthusiasm any more than we shared his boredom. But no worries because we figured out the system. Sales tax indeed, not on our watch. Two boys on bikes, each with their small paper sack of candy. It was a good day. And it was too. Well, you think about it, with a dollar, 50 pieces of candy. That's a whole day worth of fun and deliciousness and sugary treats all day long. Just forget, and you know, that was the thing. We didn't take things for granted so much. Not that I fault anybody nowadays because you guys have more to work with. And that's fantastic. But back then, we didn't have anything to work with. So we actually had to get out there for hours finding pop bottles. We did a service, actually, you know. We cleaned up the world and we were rewarded for it. And we got out there, we exercised, we got into the sun. Boy, we got baked in the sun too. By the end of summer, we were chocolate brown too. I mean, we got out there and we got tans. We were, I'm glad I didn't get skin cancer. Anyway, yes, it was a good day. The summer seemed to last forever and yet you blink your eye and the summer was over. Donnie and I made the most of every single day. Not 1 minute was wasted on iPhones, Xbox, or Facebook. Friend requests were made face to face. Video games were long into the future, so every minute of summer was savored in the warm, sunny days at the local pool or fishing for bullhead, catfish, and carp at the Arkansas River with our little El Chipo. And they were El Chipo Zedco fishing poles for a dollar. A day, you'd have to go a day without candy. For a dollar, we would sift through the kites at Woolworths to find just the right one. Woolworths had this little section right up by the cash register, and they had paper kites and they had plastic kites. Plastic kites cost more, of course. Paper kites were those diamond-shaped kites that you had to tear up a sheet apart and make a little tail for them or an old shirt or something like that. Plastic kites were easier to fly. They went back and forth. The paper kites, those had the advantage of going up farther. So if you wanted distance, you went for the paper kite. If you wanted fancy, you went for the plastic kites. Anyway, we went to Woolworths to find just the right one for epic kite fights of summer. Donnie, I have to admit, was the king of flying distance. On the other hand, I was the self-proclaimed, and Donnie would disagree, I was the self-proclaimed master of kite diving, otherwise known as crashing. But let's just say it was diving because it helps me feel better about my chronic destruction of so many kites. And oh, it was a sick feeling. You know, you go out there, you collect bottles, and you'd go and get yourself a kite, and you get it up there in the air, and then for some reason, you don't know why, an act of God, this kite was flying really good, and all of a sudden, it would just do this. And no matter what you did, boys and some girls, you know this, no matter what you did, you let off on the line, you pull the line left to right, that kite was just gravity bound and it went flying down to the ground and you would see it way off in the distance. We did this on the school playground in the summer when there's no kids around. And it would just go down and you would just hear it would hit and it would take a few seconds for the sound to get back to us. And then we'd hear just a thunk and you knew your kite's spine was broken, the bar in the back, and you could try and tape it, but it was never quite the same. It would fly like this crippled puppy. It was just so sad. But yeah, then you'd have to save up and go buy another kite. At times, our kites would soar so incredibly high, we lost sight of them and feared they would hit an airplane. It could happen in a kid's mind. Heck, anything could happen because we were kids and nobody had yet taught us all the things that were not possible. The days of summer as a child are precious and all too few. At times, I wonder if I would have lived them differently if I had it to do over again. That's a thing I ponder now. My answer always seems to come around to no. Absolutely not. I spent endless hours of countless days watching ants do what ants do, sitting in the sun on the picnic table, just dangling my feet as my thoughts wandered, bologna sandwiches and Kool-Aid, riding bikes and yo-yos, slug bug, no returns, and television with only three channels, every Friday night at 9 p.m., the ritual begging of my mom to let me stay up an extra half hour to watch Twilight Zone or Night Gallery, my two favorite shows. Most of the times, she relented, and I figured it was more of her unwillingness to listen to me cry for a half hour. So many common and unremarkable events filled my summers of childhood in Gardendale, but it was those seemingly unmemorable little nuggets of time that created and filled the rich tapestry of my childhood, and I now remember them with such fondness and gratitude. A simple time of simple happiness I would not want to relive or remake. It was perfect It was perfect as it was because it was a unique and fleeting childhood that was mine alone. No matter where I go or how my life path twists and turns, I look back and smile. And that's where I want to leave off. I know it's just a short reading, but I wanted to let off on that one because I wanted to tell you something. With the childhood thing, people do ask me that, and you know, I get into conversations every now and then about what would you do? You know, you get into deep conversations when you're with your friends sometimes. What would you do different if you were a kid? And a lot of people think, well, I would do this different, I'd do that different. And my answer always comes back to, I wouldn't change a thing. Because if I knew then what I know now, I wouldn't have made my mistakes. I wouldn't have sat at the picnic table and just looked up at the stars and watched the leaves in the tree. I would have tried to make more of a use of it. But the thing is that my really perfect memories are all the imperfect things that I did as a kid. It was all of those things that make me who I am. You know, it's the puzzle pieces. So I don't want to change any of that because I am very happy with who I am and what I am right now today. And it's that past that led me here. So no, I wouldn't change it. You know, there are a lot of bad memories and you're going to hear so many things in the future on the reading of the book. But it was all of those things that make the memories so beautiful. And I do have quite a few beautiful memories, and I cherish them because they are unique. All of your memories of your childhood, nobody has a childhood like you had. And no matter how bad it was, no matter how weird it was, somewhere down the line, there were some good memories. And those cannot be duplicated by anybody else. They belong to you. And that's worth more than anything for me, is to know that that is inside me and it'll never go away. Anyway, sorry for drawing on about that, but I just wanted to remind you of that be a little grateful for some of the simple things that you have, because it's something that nobody else has except for you. Now, I'm going to stop for now, but I'm going to continue next Thursday with a longer version of this, because the next part has to be a longer version. That's why I cut off now, because I'm going on to something a little bit different. Next week, Thursday, join me for story time again. And until then, don't forget, tune in on Sunday for the regularly scheduled Praxis 55712 program. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, it's going to be in here, because I want to film it today. But it's windy and it's 30 degrees out. Actually, it's going to be 30 degrees. I'm lucky if it's 20, and there's no way you're getting me out there. Well, you can get me out there, but you're not going to get me to smile about it. So I have something that's actually very garden related I want to bring to you on the Praxis 55712 channel this Sunday, this Sunday. And also, don't forget, on the Voodoo Garden channel, we have something at your knee. I haven't forgot about that. I hope you haven't either. It's very, very special, and it's progressing very nice. Okay, I got to get going. Thank you for joining me for Storytime. I hope you appreciate it. Let me know what you think about it in the comment section below. Until next week, this is Ray. Have a great day. Okay, time to go.